We begin this December 7th, 2017 Standing Policy Committee on Finance regular meeting. I'm joined, I'm Scott Gillingham, City Councilor, St. James, Brooklyn's Western Ward, joined today by my council colleagues, Councilor Mays, Councilor Lukes, Councilor Allard, our clerk, Mr. Sherwood Armbruster, and our CFO, Mr. Mike Ruda, and members of our administration as well. We have seven items on the agenda today. I will begin entertaining a motion to receive the previous minutes. Anyone? Thank you. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Thank you. Okay, we don't have any delegations this morning?
There are no delegations this morning.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Mr. Burke, begin today then with the financial status report and forecast to October 31st, 2017. I see we're joined by Mr. Olson as well, so good morning.
Chair, we're going to be presenting to October 31st. This is the actuals that that's October 31st projected at the end of the year. Again, I'll turn it over to Paul to take you through the report.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. Good morning, Chairman Gillingham. Good morning, councillors. The as our CFO has indicated already, this is reporting at the end of October, so we do have a couple more months in the year of our fiscal year. At this point in time, the tax support general revenue fund is projecting a surplus of $1.7 million, which is up a little bit from what we were presenting at our last finance committee meeting, where the surplus was reported at $400,000. The one thing in the executive summary, just to bring to your attention, again, for the most part, the report is very consistent with the wording that we've had in previous reports. Obviously, some of the numbers have changed. I will highlight for you, though, the amount anticipated to be transferred from the Financial Stabilization Reserve Fund is now down to $100,000. In our last report, we had talked about $500,000 being transferred over. The again, the net taxes added forecast against budget is coming in a little bit lower than expected, which is why at this time the reserve can afford only $100,000. One thing to bring to your attention as well, just looking at the recommendations, in fact we have two recommendations this time. The very first one is the normal one, of course, to receive this report as information, but this report will also go on to EPC and council with your approval. Just in the event that the General Revenue Fund does report a deficit at year end, we do need to come up with a solution to deal with that. So in this case, in the event that the General Revenue Fund is reporting a deficit at year end, although at this point it's reporting a surplus, it will require, under this recommendation, a transfer from the Financial Stabilization Reserve Fund to cover off any shortfall in the General Revenue Fund. And in the event that that transfer takes the Financial Stabilization Reserve Fund below the minimum balance that's required, which is 6% of tax supported expenditures, we do require council approval to do that. The intention, of course, as part of that approval, is that we do need a replenishment plan. The plan, of course, starting no later than 2019, would be to replenish whatever that shortfall is over a period of no more than 3 years. Just to go into the report a little bit further, on page 3, in the event, we just talked about, in the event that the General Revenue Fund is in a deficit position, but as page 3 notes, in the event that we're in a surplus position, any surplus would be transferred into the Financial Stabilization Reserve Fund. That is a an approval council has already given as part of the Financial Stabilization Reserve Fund's setup.
Can you just ask?
Yes,
Item 1 and 2. Item 2, about this time of year, is a fairly standard recommendation, right? When like that's consistent with other years that this recommendation would be brought forward, so this report would go beyond this committee to EPC and then to council for this purpose?
Correct.
So we included this clause previously at this final?
We have. There's been a little bit of a nuance, councillor, in the sense that in previous years where we've had sufficient, or we think we've had sufficient balance in the Financial Stabilization Reserve Fund, there's a couple triggers we'll do first. One is to not transfer in the interest revenue to the Financial Stabilization Reserve Fund. So it's entitled to interest, so we would keep that as part of the General Revenue Fund. And to the extent that there's any surplus of, say, net, over net taxes added budget, we would keep that in the General Revenue Fund as well. given the situation where we're marginal, very margin, razor thin in terms of what that balance is right now, it doesn't, there's no benefit in doing so whatsoever. So it just keeps it simplified, just there's a shortfall transfer from the Financial Stabilization Reserve Fund. Cost mitigation measures update, there really is nothing further to update at this point. Again, $9.5 million target, and the forecast incorporates $9.5 million of council-approved cost mitigation measures. On the provincial funding and other, on page 5, the discussion on transit, things continue to improve there. You'll recall, of course, that transit did put forward their own cost mitigation measures to deal with shortfalls in provincial funding and the passenger fare revenue shortfalls that they were seeing this year. But if you look at the transfer from the general revenue fund, comparing what was reported in September to October, you see there is a continued improvement, again, marginal. But in September, the additional transfer from general revenue fund was $1.2 million. We're now down to a little under a million at $0.9 million. So that is improved. I'm going to jump ahead to page 7, where we discuss police services. There has been no change there in terms of provincial funding implications dealing with the cadet program and the helicopter maintenance program. On the fire paramedic service side, of course, there has been some discussion on that over the last few days. So again, just to highlight, this report does not include any potential shortfall that has been identified over the past couple of days of approximately $2.5 million for the current year. The public service is in discussions with Winnipeg Health, Regional Health Authority on that. Again, are seeking further clarification on the implications to 2017, given the late timing of that announcement.
It's an important reminder, this is a report to the end of October, and that means it comes to us until almost the end of November, so fair point you bring up.
The assessment appeals.
I have.
Sure, of course, yes.
We haven't dealt with this before that I'm aware of. If there was a large scale layoff of ambulance staff, if we go out of the business of paramedics and there's a severance liability, is that out of a reserve or is that out of what? How would that be? I know at the DPC last night there was options on that. So if something like that occurred, and there was severance payments being paid, we do have a severance account, budget account, which is not a large amount, it's approximately $800,000 or something, give or take. And so that would be used in parts. If there exceeded that amount, then we would have to deal with it as an investment in general revenue fund.
Assessment appeals, again, no further changes or updates here. Again, $2.2 million additional provision has been included in this forecast with the further $4.6 million potential shortfall to be dealt with through 2018 budget. Just to talk about some of the variances in Schedule 2, again, these are comparing the forecast to what has been budgeted. Has not been a significant amount of change. Obviously, some of the numbers are changing in this schedule, but in large part, the message and the disclosures are very comparable with what we've had in the past number of reports. The one new item to bring to your attention that is being disclosed in this schedule is property planning, property and development. Total of $1.1 million positive variance against their budget. Part of that is in part due to some cost mitigation measures that they had implemented earlier this year, but they're also seeing some positive variances in position vacancies, positions not being filled on a timely basis. So in total, $1.1 million positive financial variance in that respect.
If I can just ask on that, is there any indication of where their permit revenue is at this year compared to last year?
Yeah, it has been bouncing around a little bit, Councillor, at this point. And it would be net of any transfer. They are over budget, better than budget. They have a net transfer to the reserve. I think it's around, it's under $1 million, Councillor. It might be $500,000 or so. Just trying to find it here. Yeah, right now it's a net $400,000 to the good.
Okay. If I could just ask one more question regarding to transit. I'm actually kind of going back into your report on page, I guess, 4 or 5, where the forecast in September, the variance was the transfer from general revenue fund of $1.2 million. It improved by the end of October to just under $1,900,000. But does transit give reasons for the improvement? Is it continuation of cost mitigation, or have their fare revenues increased, or do you know the answer to that?
The table, although it is a big table and somewhat complicated on page 5, will show that, Councillor. But to your point, the very first line, when you look at passenger fares and other revenue, you'll notice that in September the forecasted variance was a $6.3 million shortfall, whereas the October variance is down to $6 million. So there's been a little bit of improvement in terms of that line. Expenses have also improved, 1, 2, 3, the fourth line down. Again, September, $2.7 million positive variance, now 2.9. So to me, that's more just fine-tuning as some of the numbers come in for another month. You know, they will vary a little bit, and to me, that's within tolerance of a little bit of variability that'll happen.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions, Councillor Lukes?
I have some questions. So this is the report that we're seeing now for the first time using funding from the savings for the rapid transit corridor, correct? Remember every finance committee I ask about this, our 0.33 in savings? So on page 6 here, on page 6. So what we're doing is we're taking $1.7 million, as I understand it, out of that reserve. Correct?
Well,
it's not going into the reserve.
It's provincial funding that was intended to come to transit to cover that. It's not coming to transit.
I know
so
that.
The amount's not going to be transferred into the reserve.
Yeah.
So we're taking out of the reserve?
No, it's not going in. So we anticipated it was going to come in from the province,
right.
1.7, and we were going to transfer it right back into the reserve. So now there's no way we're not seeing it, so we're not transferring it into the reserve because there's nothing to transfer.
Right. So what are we doing with that reserve still? Have we taken any money out of that reserve?
There's two reserves. One was the stage one reserve, through this process hasn't been touched, but the stage two reserve.
Okay, so stage one still hasn't been touched?
No, that's right.
Do you know how much is in stage one?
It's
approximately?
I think $3 million.
$3 million.
$4 million in that range. I think that there was there's been a draw in terms of the budget.
This year's budget?
2018 budget. That's correct. Yeah.
So what did we on stage one rapid transit?
That's right.
The reserve.
Yes.
So where have we seen that occur? Is that in the budget?
You don't see it in the forecast, but you'll see it in the budget document. I could probably show it to you in the transfer section.
And what are we doing with that?
Well, that's helping in terms of the operating budget, to balance.
So how much are we taking out of that?
I can get you the exact number, Councillor.
Like $1 million, $2 million, $3
million? No, that'd be about $1.2 million.
So we're taking that out of stage one of the rapid transit reserve.
Right.
That, okay, sure. So
The second reserve, though, there's no amounts that are being taken, so if you get we're expecting 1.7 to come in, but we also have a reduced amount of contract, like was previously estimated by 90, it's down to 467 with a $69 million contingency included. So the anticipated payments are less, and as a result, the 0.33 is sufficient to be able to make those payments when they do occur in 2020.
But there's still a surplus, that we still have a surplus in stage two.
There'll be some surplus left.
So of the $120 million savings that we had on the P3, was there a final determination? I know that you were working on determining how much was the provinces, how much savings was the cities, and how much savings was the P3.
Yes, we have that. We know exactly how much is being, you know, divided up between each partner, but there's still discussions going on with the province in terms of the allocations.
So I guess my question is, how much was the city's savings on that? Every committee I ask this, right?
Yeah.
And every committee you say it's going to come forward. And
I have some details on that, and I could provide it to you. Actually, it was provided at by the transit department sometime last summer once they finished up the contract. But
I'm not aware that there was an identified breakdown. There was always the discussion or the debate on who got what percentage of the $120 million.
We have a defined breakdown this week. So I can provide that.
So we have a breakdown of that.
Yeah. And
so then, I mean, even if it was a third, which it's not, like, so let's just say it was, for purposes of, you know, talking about this. So the third that's left, we're not drawing anything on that for stage two. We're not drawing anything out on stage two.
Well, remember that the allocations are reduced for each partner. Our partnership portion is the payments that are due to the P3
partner. Other than that, are we drawing any funds out of the stage two reserve that are not related to the P3 payments?
No, we're not drawing.
But we are out of stage one.
That's correct. That balance, and that was only during the budget. It's not during the these forecasts.
Really, I find that. I don't know. That stage one. I was involved in stage one. There's a few things that still need to, in my opinion, and others' opinions, need to be done on stage one. And we were always told that it would be held for transit. So you're pulling it out to put it towards operating.
There's a portion, yes, that a portion, not the full amount of the what's left in stage one reserve, a portion is being proposed in the preliminary budget to be utilized for the 2018 budget.
And you're clearly identifying that on some page, because I clearly have missed that.
I can provide you. I don't have my books here and everything.
Sure, but do you say this comes from the stage one transit reserve?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
I missed that. Okay.
Okay, other questions at all?
Just give me a minute here, back to transit here. So in regards then to stage two, the general reserve for transit, not general reserve, what are you calling it? You're calling it do you have a name for it specifically?
Sorry.
Pembina Highway underpayment reserve, underpass payment reserve? What do you call that reserve? What's the name for stage two reserve? Is there a name or no?
Southwest Rapid Transitway 2
and Pembina Highway underpayment, underpass payment reserve.
Yeah.
Okay, I can see why you don't remember it. all right, so I'm seeing there's nothing else happening to that reserve. You're saying there's nothing else happening to that reserve other than the payments that are coming out of that reserve for P3.
That's correct.
In 18 and 19. Is there something happening in 20 or what?
The payments start. We start making our payments in 19, and then all future
years. I'm just
out of that reserve.
So you're going to send me then. You're going to send me the breakdown and what the sort of city's portion of money is in that reserve. That's over and above the cost of transit. So why aren't we pulling from that reserve? Why aren't we pulling from that reserve to help our transit issues now? I guess that's a question to Councillor Gillingham.
Yeah. To be frank, it is, we've said it before, is that there's still uncertainty, you know, around some discussions with the province on some of these matters. So, you know, I've said before, too, in my own mind, it would be not the time now to be drawing out of or even reducing the 0.33 payment into the reserve. That's my view. Obviously, it's up for council discussion, but yeah.
Because the savings is going to be around $20-30 million, our portion of the savings.
Yeah, those are, once again, Councillor, those are savings that are shared between P3 Canada, the province,
right,
and the city. So what happens in those cases, it's reduced grant payments from what we originally expected.
Sure. But we're still charging taxpayers the same amount of money for a project that was initially pegged at $120 million more than it is. So we're still collecting on the higher-priced project.
Although we also anticipated in our original projections $1.7 million from the province to go into that reserve. And it's not going in.
Right, but we're not taking it out of that reserve.
Pardon me?
Right, we're not.
Yeah, so yeah. That's even though there's reduced payments, there's mm-hmm. also reduced revenue coming mm-hmm. in. Mm-hmm.
But in that 0.33, we did not select that amount and anticipate that 1.7 million in. We had made that decision prior.
Throughout that reserve, based on the higher value of the, it was based on a $580 million project or $590 million project, the payments were much higher, and the 1.7 was assisting in terms of those payments. Now that the amount's reduced, the 1.7, the province hasn't provided the 1.7, so fortunately the 0.33 does cover it, and there is some surplus in there projected.
Sure. So there's
not a great value at this point, but as
so you don't have any idea, you don't remember 10, 20, 30, 40 million, like you don't have any idea what that surplus of the city's portion is?
I can get those numbers for you. I prefer sure. to actually just refer sure. to it because they're not at my fingertips.
Okay. So we do have a surplus in the transit fund, though, if we wanted to access it, to if it was a council decision to access it.
There, as Councillor, as the Chair was just mentioning, there is still this issue of defining with the province what that value, what their contribution is going to be, so sure. that has a potential impact on that, sir.
Okay. Okay, other questions at all? Okay, Mr. Wolf and both of those other aspects of this report you wanted to highlight here?
No, Mr. Chairman, I think I've covered the pertinent points that I wanted to bring up today.
Okay.
Yeah, just let me ask one yes. more question here. This is in regards to the ambulance. So how are we balancing that? You're doing a 90-day request, but how are we balancing the budget? Where is that deficit?
So the budget is balanced.
Right.
If you take
but for 2017, we have, yeah. we've got the letter from the...
Yeah.
WRHA, and we didn't plan on that.
Nope.
So we tabled on the same day, we tabled a balanced budget,
mm-hmm.
and we didn't plan on not receiving the 2017 funding
mm-hmm.
or the 2018.
As for, yes. And so
how can it be balanced?
As, well, first of all, for 2017, as you know, as Mr. Ruta said, the discussions are ongoing with the province, and you've seen even the motion that for 2017, frankly asking WRHA to make us whole on 2017 and honor the terms of the agreement.
Right. But when we vote on it next week, it's not balanced.
I'm talking 2017. Now, yes. 2018 yes. is balanced. The 2018 budget that we have before us, not before us, but the preliminary budget, is a balanced budget. Every budget, including this budget, the 2018 budget, is built on assumptions. These even assumptions of revenue for permits. There's assumption of revenue for fees, right? It's all assumptions. We also have assumptions of expenses, and so every budget is that. It's a projection for the next 12 months, right? There's assumptions on federal funding, on provincial funding, all over the budget. That's what a budget is. So this budget. We don't have in front of us, but the budget for 2018, the preliminary budget, is a balanced budget. Discussions with WRHA will be ongoing, and you know, I've made clear my position, and you know, unanimously EPC adopted that yesterday, and so the discussions with the WRHA will continue. don't know if you want to add anything further to that.
But we're not assuming, we're pretty clear that what we're, we sent a letter, we're pretty clear, so.
And we're, yes, and we're responding very clearly, right? We're responding very clearly to them as well, to say you need to make us whole on 2017, mm-hmm. and we're asking them to honor the 2018 forecast, which would be based on the terms of the agreement, which is now expired, but which, you know, both parties have been operating as if those terms of the agreement were still going on.
That's correct. Yeah, and the way budgets are prepared, and it's in the charter, is based on estimates. And as Councillor Gillingham spoke, the estimates are based on that previous agreement, which was carried along as if it was going to continue, and that's the assumptions that were made in building budget. Now that we know, which unfortunately was after...
So now there's no more agreement and no more assumptions. We have facts.
Well, we knew we didn't have an agreement, but that agreement was being in good faith, being continued to operate in the same manner. But now that we know that the provinces changed their way of operating it and basing it on a 2016 baseline funding model, going back, and we've been communicating with the WRHA on this point and basically saying, look, this has created approximately a $4.1 million or $4.6 million hole in our 2018 budget. And the options are increase revenue to us, make us whole for that amount, suggest what the WRHA might be suggesting in terms of the service reductions, and providing that information to us, because we can't absorb or don't want to absorb that $4.1 million at this late stage when we're operating on the basis of previous agreement that had expired. Mm-hmm. So estimates, we have all sorts of estimates in our budgets, and as you can see, Councillor, when we do the our forecast, we're $1.7 million mm-hmm. to the good at this stage. But I should also mention that our budget is $1 billion, mm-hmm. and $1.7 on a billion-dollar budget is razor thin. So I think there's always some movement in our budget lines mm-hmm. During the course of the year.
Few years, I know that.
So we can't expect to be exact on those numbers.
Yeah, yeah.
That was based on our best estimates at the time that when we were preparing the budget. We know otherwise now, and we're going to have those discussions to make ourselves whole during the course of the year. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions? Okay, I entertain a motion then to receive this report, and it will go on to EPC, right, on this one?
You're concurring in the recommendations to receive one and approve number two.
Okay. Someone so move. So move, Councillor Mays. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Olson. Okay, item number two, major capital project reporting schedule.
This is our regular schedule that we provided, and everybody who's reporting today is on the schedule as well. We have a lot of TBAs in the schedule, SPC finance meetings. We'll be able to fill that in next meeting. I understand the mm-hmm. schedules were introduced yesterday, so we'll be able to bring that forward and update that in our report.
Okay. Councilor Mays.
I had a question. There's a major announcement last week about the province on combined sewers that doesn't appear in this list, because even though it was 25, it currently is $25, $26 million a year, year after year after year. But it's not a one-off thing. It's capital, so I'm trying to ask it here under the capital line. But can we get some report, perhaps at either this committee or water committee at a future meeting, on what the province's letter basically, I came up with a back of envelope estimate of what it would cost, and I think I'm in the ballpark at least, according to the minister. So Can we get some report back? I know it's not necessarily a major terminology thing. It's certainly a major capital project we're doing over a 40-year arc, but it's not a defined box like these things. So is there some way we can get a report back on what the financial implications are of the province's letter? And it may be premature to do that because it is not terrifically specific.
Maybe we could, Councillor, maybe Moira is going to be up next on some of these reports. We can ask her to speak to that if you don't mind.
Okay, that'd be good. Okay, entertain a motion then to receive this major capital project reporting schedule. Councillor Lukes, it's been moved. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
And you're approving recommendations 2 and 3.
Yes. That's right. Okay, item number 3, North End Sewage Treatment Plant.
We'll have Moira and her group come forward, Councillor, and they'll be speaking in the next 3.
Okay. Yeah. Councillor Mays, I'm going to turn the chair to you for a moment, please.
All right. Thank you.
Good morning, councillors. The first report we have on the agenda is the North End upgrade, and this report takes us to the end of August, although I guess there is a subsequent event, and we have disclosed it in the executive summary is on the Class 5 estimate, which is probably like the biggest item in this report is the Class 5 estimate. We had this is like giving early warning again. This is still a Class 5 estimate. What we carry in our budget right now is $795 million. The Class 5 estimate now is, I'm saying it could be up to $1.4 billion. However, it still is a Class 5 estimate, and we continue to work on the design. So we will have a Class 3 estimate in the summer of 2018, at which time we'll have a different we'll have a better estimate.
A Class 3 in summer of 2018.
Yeah. The design is ongoing. I guess what we're doing is we're alerting committee that this is the Class 5 estimate that we have now, but there's a number of things that we need to do over the next year, including progressing with the design and looking at if that really is the number, then how do we, what would our procurement strategy be to sort of manage that larger price tag if that's what it actually turns out to be. And of course there's the looking at the numbers and looking in the future what that might possibly do to sewer rates as well, right? Because we don't carry $1.4 billion in our plan right now.
I have a very detailed question which I'll proceed with since my colleagues. But go ahead.
Well, mine, I guess it just sort of go through with us how it got to $1.59 billion. That goes from, you're working on the Class 5 design, right? On the Class 5 price.
I'll let Jeff speak to the details.
Yeah, Class 5 is extremely high level, high risk number that was put forward. It has a very large range of minus 50 to 100%. It's based on less than 2% of design. So we put that forward and so that people had an understanding of the size of this project, and then began to engage our owner's advocate. We decided that design build was the procurement strategy. Bear in mind as well, this was a roll-in of the biosolids component, a very large component, the cornerstone of our biosolids project. It made sense. It was less risky to combine it with the North End upgrade as well. But in terms of once we started working with our consultant, I think we discussed it in our last financial status report, there were several changes to the budget that we went through. Those would include the U.S. dollar exchange that was estimated was too high and needed to be adjusted. There were lessons learned from our South End job. Specifically, we talked about the electrical and instrumentation. that it was done even at the class three estimate at the south end. It was done as a kind of per square meter, per square foot of the building cost, a rule of thumb number. And then when we actually went to the class one estimate for South End, we got a much higher number. We raised the flag about that number. Bids came in higher than we anticipated, but lower than the class one. And the project remains on budget, even though with a very small contingency going forward. So we took that lesson learned on a much bigger project for North End and needed to reevaluate that component. The electrical and instrumentation review or work at the North End will be is a really big a big item. There were several risks that we monetized through the Class 5 estimate, and then as we began the design, these grew. So the amount of money that we assigned to some risks, and if they did come to fruition, needed to be accounted for in the budget, and therefore much higher contingencies were included with the project budget. That's really the basis of how the project grew. We now know more than we did before. Class five estimates are very risky. As Moyer indicated, the design is continuing so that we know what this plant, a class three estimate is what our city standard is before we tender. But we need to know what this project costs. And we're not putting any further monies toward or forward in the budget process until we can take this back and take a look at procurement strategies to look at how we deliver a project like this and whether there are opportunities to reduce the cost. I can tell you one of the biggest opportunities to reduce cost is to mitigate risk over the life of the project. And that's something we're continually focused on almost on a daily basis. So. But the plan is what the plan is. We have a series of environmental license regulations to meet. There are opportunities to reduce the costs through some potential changes, but we're proceeding with the design of the plant at this point, and then we'll report back once we get a class three and give council a better indication of what the project cost is more likely to be.
So who's putting these class estimates together? Is this with...
The original class estimate was put together by the City of Winnipeg and our Veolia partners. The Winnipeg Sewage Treatment Program, they're experts from around the world consulted. So, and now we are through the preliminary design, the consultant, AECOM, is developing the costs. So they'll submit their preliminary engineering to it. To an independent cost consultant, mm-hmm. who will then verify their costs for us. So, the initial cost is developed by Veolia and the city of staff based on the knowledge and other comparables for projects. And then, when the actual design is done, it's provided by the consultant and then an independent cost consultant.
And then it goes out to tender the whole project or just components of it.
Part of what we're looking at now, because of the new Class 5 estimate, I mean, the design, there's many things going on. The design is progressing, but we're looking at the procurement strategy as well.
Right.
Parts of the project are replacing old parts of the plant and looking at if we need to time it differently or if we need to incrementally make the improvements because it's such a big price tag, then we're looking at those procurement strategies and those risk mitigations. So that's part of the work that the Winnipeg Sewage Treatment Program will continue with over the next year as the design is progressing. There's sort of parallel activities. If the number was real, which we don't even know that it's real, it is an estimate, so we haven't made any decisions based upon it because it is just a revised Class 5 estimate, is a project that size. Like, I think originally the procurement strategy was a design bid, we wouldn't do that on a $1.4 billion. It's just too big. It would just be too big to do it that way. So we're looking at how you could possibly phase it or what the procurement strategy would be. So that's part of what the Veolia city team is looking at as well.
And just one last, can I ask one last
of
question?
Of course, yes.
And then, so I guess this might be, well, you folks would know it too. So, and I knew it about a year and a half ago, and I don't remember, and I'm sure it's changed quite a bit. What amount do we have approximately set aside now in our reserves towards this project?
The,
I know that we had gone through this a while ago when we were talking about the, you had given me an approximate number. Like, I just want to know how much money is sitting there that we have, you know.
You know what?
When we were talking about dividends, when we were working on the dividends, they had gone to some interesting detailed work and had sent it to me.
Can you get that for me?
I'll have to go off.
But there's a lot of numbers, and I just don't.
Give me a couple minutes.
Yeah, Mike can look up that, that number.
I got transit number, too, on the wall.
Thanks, Mike.
I'll get the lead for you as well.
She says with a wink as well. So, okay. Mr. Mays.
I'm trying to sort out something. You find it on the last page of the report, and I started going back to when this item came on in 2015 and 2014. And on the last page, it talks about total cost, and the number adds up to $795 million, because that's what we have set aside, either in the reserves, as Councillor Luke's saying, or debt authority. We have worked that through the previous budget. So $795 million. You see, Environment Act license driven is 466 and other is 329. If you go back to the 2015 report, that 466 number doesn't change, but the other drop was only 103. If you go back to 14, the 466 doesn't change, but the other is 81. So I'm trying to figure out, as this has gone forward, looking at that, it's like the province gave us something to do, and that cost hasn't escalated at all, it would appear, since 2014. It must be these other costs that are escalating. Interrelated with that, perhaps, is if you look at the 2015 budget, biosolids is a $200 million project, and we're coming to that in one or two items. And of course, we moved like $182 million or something out of biosolids over to North End in 2016 budget. So I don't need it today, but I need, please, someone to explain why the Environment Act license number appears to have locked in for several years while the other stuff went up. And yet now we're saying, oh, there's another $500-600 million we're going to have to spend, and that's due to, perhaps I'm putting words in your mouth, but it sounds like you're saying due to the Environment Act license component. So somebody make sense of this for me, please. It may have to do with the movement of the biosolids within the budget, because suddenly the biosolids went from being a $200 million project to like a $20 million project, so the cost had to go somewhere. It went into the North End construction project, but I'm you know, we got, frankly, a wild, to me, wild estimate about from in the Hempson report that a quarter of this plant cost was due to new growth, which frankly seemed arbitrary to me. But looking at this, you could say, oh, maybe that was conservative. Maybe almost half of it's new growth. So I would like some breakdown of those numbers.
We can, sure. Councilor, we can certainly provide that information to the committee. That's a takeaway for us.
Thank you.
It's the Environmental Projects Reserve. Capital Reserves, it's right there. Yeah, right here, forecasted for 2017.
$61,078,000.
Yeah.
The forecasted balance at...
Look, we have the number, Councilor Luke.
Pardon me? Sorry.
The forecasted balance at the end of 2017 is $61 million.
In the reserve.
You kidding? $61 million? Mm-hmm. $61 million.
What happens with those reserves? We've seen it with the water reserve when we were building the water treatment plant. We wrap it up with rates. That's our cash going in. And then we balance it with debt. Yeah. And then it starts drawing down. So it's a very smart financing one we have.
Any other questions, Councillor Mays?
It could be here, it could be in the next items, about the question I asked earlier about can we get some report in a few months, maybe about the CSO implications. The province has finally responded back to us. It would be reasonable, but I don't know if it's
Okay, so you're looking specifically for the financial implications?
Yeah, I think that's more appropriately here than at the Water Committee.
Yeah.
At your discretion.
Yeah, that would. Yeah. Is that something, do you need clarity on the request or?
You know what, perhaps, I guess just to describe what's happened with the CSO, we got a letter a couple of weeks ago, and that was in response to the preliminary master plan. Mm-hmm. So now what we have, what the city has, is I think it's 21 to 24 months to come up with the final master plan. That's what the province has given us. So I think we can report back on what we're doing sort of from this letter that we've got now to what we're going to put forward in our final master plan. So I don't know if it would necessarily, I mean, we can put forward just factually what's in their letter and what work we're doing to get us to the 21 months from now. So the exact financial impact, I think that will be determined over that period of time, depending upon kind of the time frame the city was targeting and the time frame that the province has put forward and how the city will respond to that. So we could report back. I don't think we could come back and say exactly this is how much more it will cost. I think the Jeff and his team are looking at that right now, right? So I think we can give a general response about what our plan forward is between now and the next phase of the process.
I'm just trying to make sure I understand. So once you get to the next phase of the process, though, there will be the very kind of breakdown that Councillor Mays is looking for, right? That would say year over year, you know, here's what the capital program will have to be to meet the timeline that the province has given us, and is that in essence what we're looking for?
Yeah, I mean, it's a little, you got a 27-year arc. You could do all the work in years 25, 26, and 27 if you wanted to, but if you just smooth it out, there's a certain number I worked out, so I appreciate there's no telling the future. But I guess, yeah, some sort of figure that says this creates an additional obligation of X, we estimate between now and 2045, that would be something. When you do the work, it's...
And the date is key, right? The date is very key, but we've found, like, as we've gone, like, even with the sewage treatment plant upgrades, we negotiate compliance dates with the province as well, right? So I think that would be part of it. I think certainly the letter that we received is probably faster than what we've envisioned in our long-term financial plan and capital investment plan, but you know, we're actively working on it, right? We have been for years. We continue to work on it, and the city's approach was like incrementally improve and get us to that target. So I think there's more discussions that have to happen between the city and the province, but we can give like a preliminary report on what that is. But you know, that's not the you know, it's good. I wouldn't call it the fait accompli because we've still got this other process to go through on the final plan. But we can report back, and I'm not sure if that's this committee or the Water and Waste Committee.
Maybe this committee is finance, or it's you and I said on both committees, but
yeah, that's true.
Maybe yeah, Water Waste because it'd be the...
Yes.
Okay.
Exactly.
That would make more sense because it's not just the dollars. It's the... Okay. Whole project process. Okay, thank you. Any other questions? I have a couple, but from anyone? Okay. I guess the one question I have, again, is regarding the cost report in the table, on the milestones table 2, which is page 415 of this report. Under the main plant upgrade, item 3, cost report, scheduled for July 2018. That's the Class 3 report, right, that you're expecting to get by that time?
That's correct.
Which, and therefore, we'll know if it's 1.4 or more or less than that, because we'll move from a Class 5 to a Class 3. Is correct?
Correct.
Okay, the question I have then is, I'm thinking about the South End plant and how when the plant, I think, when it moved from a 3 to a 1, there's that $35 million potential, you know, it came in $35 million higher. So I guess the question is, once that class three estimate is developed, What kind of analysis or rigor or checking will be done to ensure that it is an accurate Class 3 for the city of Winnipeg?
So, you know, as we indicated, we'll subject the numbers to an independent cost consultant who will take a look at those numbers to make sure that that they are good numbers and represent what our expectations are. We're going to have to put some assumptions in there in terms of delivery dates because of construction inflation that will continue. One of the issues, as we've talked about, the lessons learned from South End, specifically on the electrical and instrumentation, that was the fourth contract, the largest contract. All three previous contracts were all below the Class 3 and below the Class 1 estimate of every job. And one contract was 25% below. You know, we had anticipated it, I think, in the 40-some-odd million-dollar range, and it was in the $30 million range that we of one of the larger structures contracts. So, it's hard to gauge the industry, you know, but we did get multiple bids. We got up to four bids. But the rigor we're going to take to this is to make sure that we take the lessons learned from South End and make sure that we apply them to North End and to make sure that we get the independent cost consultant. Class 3s do have a range, but we want to make sure that, that any contingencies we assign to the project can cover that. And that's what we should be doing. So.
Okay, so that's fair. On South End, three out of the four contracts were under. Yep. One was over, and then when the bids ultimately came in, it still came in on budget. I think,
we were right? Within budget
because the bids came in lower than they were good pricing.
Yep. There was $2 million difference between bids. We got multiple bids, and we were within the project budgets, right. But we're proceeding with a lower contingency than typical. But all good news story on the South End, really.
The North End, then I think Ms. Gere, you were just saying that. The initial plan is a design build, but as the potential cost, as the estimate grows, then you may move away from one big contract and something this big would be most likely broken, if it comes in at these numbers, broken into a few contracts rather than one big one? Is that what you're saying?
I think that's what we would be looking at, maybe some smaller DBs. I mean, the procurement strategy is being looked at, but we can't afford a big bang, $1.4 billion. It's not affordable for ratepayers if we try to do it that way, and who knows if the market even has any contractors that could take on a project that size or bond for a project that size. So that's what part of Jeff and his team are looking at in terms of if we had to phase the work, how could we... compartmentalize the work so that we could phase it, and that's part of what his Jeff's staff and the Veolia staff are looking at over the next year as we continue. There's sort of parallel activities going on with the design.
Sort of just one, but as Margaret indicated, there's currently a plan to continue on with the DB process. There are a lot of benefits to the city, the innovation, accountability, a lot of benefits, as opposed to a traditional design bid build. So where you'd have hundreds of contracts that would go out and try to manage those. So I certainly larger but more contained and projects that make sense at the North End.
It's the big obvious question. I think we talked about before, but I'll ask it again. Are there other options that have been explored that would enable the city to meet its targets rather than a $1.4 billion plant? Are there other methodologies in other jurisdictions, other means, other ways to hit the effluent nutrient targets that would not cost $1.4 billion?
Million-dollar question.
$4 billion question.
I'll just quickly make a comment, and I'll turn it over to Jeff. I mean, to do the nutrient removal, you can do it chemically or biologically, and it's within the Save the Lake Winnipeg Act, which amends the Water Protection Act, which says we have to do it biologically for maximum reuse of the phosphorus. So we did look at other options, but there's sort of one of two ways, and I think we continue to look at if there's newer technologies or what other what other sewage treatment plants have there operating, and I'm going to turn it over to Jeff to speak to that in a little more detail.
So, you know, Moira is absolutely correct in terms of the technologies. There are really only two buckets of sewage treatment, chemical and biological treatments. In Western Canada and much of North America, biological treatment is a standard. Sewage treatment, as Moira indicated, you lose the opportunities for a lot of the nutrient resources because they are chemically bound and can't be split apart. It cannot be reused, so they would go into our biosolids and potentially be landfilled without a reuse strategy. Chemical systems are slightly cheaper to build, but they have higher annual operating costs than a biological system. A biological system is more costly to build at the initial, but has lower operating costs. We cultivate the organisms, the bugs, to do the sewage treatment for us. As long as we keep them happy, things are good. You know, the bugs like a certain environment, and that's what the challenge of a biological system is. But in terms of, and we all know that the initial costs of a project, a full life cycle cost, is what our purpose is in terms of looking at the full life cost of a project. 20% is really only in the capital. It's the operating cost. You're going to operate this plant for hundreds of years. And when you look at the operating cost, that's what you need to be looking at as a life cycle. You're looking at the next 50 years, really, you know, to make your analysis. So we have looked at a number of options. I can tell you that the process of sewage treatment is an evolving process. Is something magical going to come along in a few months? I don't know. I know of really exciting research that is going on right now in the world and in this and in our own University of Manitoba. So there is some really interesting things that are coming on, but at a project this scale, there's some hesitation. We like to use proven technologies to make sure things work. You know, we don't like to be the first large scale plants, with huge cost implications, with a technology that may or may not work. So we're always looking. You know, there's some really exciting work that's ongoing in Ireland right now. There's an exciting work in the United States in terms of biological treatment that could benefit the city. But we're going to keep our eye on it and see if we can incorporate it as we develop this project. But you know, the parameters are basically fixed. Really, there aren't. We need a certain number of processes to treat the sewage. We're going to do maximum reuse of the available assets at the north end to reduce costs and deliver the work. But they're really, you know, it's kind of two fixed endpoints. Whatever comes in and what we got out. And what we do in between.
And I think, and I appreciate Councillor May's request to get clarity on what the proportion, what portion is related to growth, what portion is related to the provincial act. And, you know, I'm reminded, you know, as I said before, I read through that act a couple of times. I just recall reading that it's required, specific to the North End plant, there's a requirement to use, and I'm not catching the phrase exactly, but best available technology, I think. So something to that, best available process or something for biological nutrient treatment. So if you take the act, I don't want to dive too deep into the rabbit hole here, but if you take the act literally, okay, that could be that if something comes out May of next year, well, we're on our way to doing our class three, and it becomes the standard in the world, then according to the legislation, we'd be required to do an about face, if we took the legislation literally, and implement that now. So, I see that the act is very, very prescriptive in to the city on that. So, anyways, yes, Councillor Mays.
Oh, it's a little unclear where we are, and I appreciate we're getting, as Councillor Luke says, the class three by summer of 18, but I kind of feel like been here 6 years almost to the day, and I mean the shovel isn't in the ground, the shovel isn't close to being in the ground, and are we waiting now for the province to say yay or nay on nitrogen, or are we it feels like the province needs to set a deadline here, or are we on some sort of deadline and they can change the requirements? I mean, right now we're being, all of the direction we've had is get phosphorus and nitrogen. They could change that, but I kind of feel like if we wait and they wait, this thing, we'll be here in another 6 years without any action.
Well, I think we've been actively working on both South End and North End. South End, the first one out of the gates, and I'm going to turn it over to Jeff again to speak about specific dates, but I mean, we had dates in the South End license that we weren't going to achieve. The city staff meet regularly with the provincial staff that, from sustainable development, like from the regulator, Sean, so I think, I'm not even sure what the date is out there. Of course, we're not going to achieve that date. We weren't going to achieve the South End date. I mean, it's really, I mean, we did have some delays on the South End, but just the size of these projects and the complexity of these projects, because when you're upgrading the plant, you're also operating the plant and staying in compliance and you know, with the brownfield construction, like it's very complicated. So I think there's recognition that the city's been actively working. Those dates aren't necessarily achievable, and we did, the South End date was amended, and the North End date, Jeff, like, I mean, whatever the date is right now, I mean, it's clearly not achievable.
I've got the act right in front of me. The city Winnipeg must, by December 31st, 2014, or by any later date specified by the regulation of the environmental license, replace the North End Water Pollution Control Center, or make modifications to it so as to ensure that on or after that date, the requirements of subsection 2 are met. And then it gives the table of, you know, what must be met. So the act said, you know, replace it by 2014 and or make modifications. And
well, I think the project itself, like, I mean, once you did actually put shovel to the ground, it's probably how many years would it be just even for the...
It's be 4 to 5 years of construction.
Yeah, so before you're even ready to start, right? Like, even once you do.
Yeah, like, in terms of the schedule of the project, you know, I can say that, you know, the entire Winnipeg Sewage Treatment Program is dedicated to moving this project forward. We've been working on it flat out the best we can. And there will be some ongoing discussions, I would assume, that on license limits, but we're beginning to develop a Class 3 plant that will deliver the effluent quality that's required, and you know, if history shows with our West End, you know, it'll perform very well. But yes, these things do take time, and in terms of decisions need to be made, we need to. If we want to see a project go sideways, you know, is to rush things. Right? So, I'm not suggesting that we're trying to move this as quick as possible, making sure that it's all eyes open and heads up as we move forward, and to give the best advice to council that we can. So, but I can tell you, you know, we knew there were early works that we could get onto. The design build for the power supply, which was a pulled out project, is in this report as well. That is going to be coming forward for an award. It's in the award phase right now. It'll be coming toward the Water and Waste Committee for award. That will be a good news story about the project as well. We'll be on budget for that project as well. So, which is a small component of the North End, obviously, but we need to set up the power for these large upgrades and get going with it to make sure that that we're ready. So, the project is moving forward, and we want to make sure that we understand the risks as we go forward.
You know what, councillors, Mr. Chair, if I could just point you to Appendix C in the report, because we've taken a lot of the verbiage and put it in the appendix. If you go to my page 15, I hope it's your page 15. Mm-hmm. If you go to the second from the bottom paragraph, where we did get the alteration letter from the province that specified December 2019, we advised them a year ago that wasn't achievable, and there were no concerns expressed at that time from sustainable development, because they know that we're actively working on the project, right? It's just it's the original dates were nowhere near possible.
All right, good. Any other comments, questions? Okay, entertain a motion to receive this report.
Good. Motion to receive this report.
Okay, thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Carried. Thank you. All right, next item, report number four, Comprehensive Integrated Waste Management Strategy for our Winnipeg Depots.
Okay, this is this financial status report takes us to the end of August, and the project sort of it's on budget and it's on schedule. The this committee is aware we have two depots open. We have one at Brady, we have one on Pacific Avenue, and our third depot, which is near completion, is at Panet and Mission. And if you've driven past, you can see like it looks like a depot. It's not close to being done. So in our report, we said it would be fourth quarter of 2018. So actually, the facility will be substantially complete by the end of the year. But then we've got operating permits that we need. We need Daryl's staff need to get out there, sort of iron out a few kinks that you have when you're opening the facility. So it'll probably open to the public towards the end of January. So it's very near. And we will, we had a couple of delays, but, and what happens is the target is the end of the year, but during the holiday season, I know we experienced that last year with Pacific, nobody was on site working because people are spending time away. So that's what we're looking at. So it's on budget, it's on schedule, and it will be opening sometime early in the new year.
Okay. Any comments, questions on this report? Councilor Mays.
If necessary, we will budget for the fourth one, but at this stage, we don't have anything set aside.
It's further out. But we're doing the, as council mandated us to do, the five-year review of the waste diversion strategy. That's going to be part of that five-year review, is to determine whether or not a fourth facility is needed, because the original approval was up to four. So we'll see.
This is probably one of, every time we have a report come forward on this, it's such a happy, it's just such a positive thing that we see a Brady that goes on out there, and it's just, I don't know, it's just really good that we're doing this, and this is a happy report amidst all this other, this is great.
Appreciate that. I think we were talking about that at one of our previous meetings. I hadn't been out to Brady Road in some time, and I went out this summer, and what a transformation. And it was very, very smooth, I'll use the word slick in a positive sense, operation. I was very, very impressed with its simplicity and just how easy it is now to achieve those diversion kind of targets or goals that have been set out. So kudos to all who've worked hard to put it together. It was very good. Any other questions, comments? Okay, I'll entertain a motion then to receive this report. Councillor Lard, thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Carried. Thank you. Next report, biosolids.
I'll turn this one over to Jeff to walk you through.
Sure. No, thanks, Mario. Okay. Yeah, the project continues on. It's good that we're reporting here both on North End and biosolids, since there is a connection to it. But so as we've talked about the biosolids program, we've submitted the master plan to the province, which has been approved. The recent activity covered by this report ending on August 31st, this is our work on the biosolids land application component of this fall we completed a pilot application in the arm of McDonald to apply biosolids in land application. As you recall, prior to 2011, the City of Winnipeg land applied significant components of our biosolids in a very successful program entitled WinGrow in terms of returning nutrients to the soil. So the key work of this project involves the land application, the public engagement processes. We're also complete, so the land application is complete. We also did some temporary storage options that we investigated near our West End plant because biosolids is not a constant supply of raw materials. It can vary with the sewage content, with the makeup of the sewage. So to better make the land application process efficient, there is some small staging. So we looked at different ways of storing the biosolids as opposed to building a massive facility and piloted that as approved by the province in September and worked to do odor control as well. So we've reported some additional expenditures related to the consultant's work on odor control and odor evaluations to minimize that. The biosolids composting facility continues to run at the Brady Resource Management Facility. As we've mentioned before, we've extended that project to May of 2018. We've had a lot of winter challenges in terms of biosolids, so we're running it through another winter to kind of get our procedures together so that we can identify costs for if biosolids composting is something we want to do going forward. Just to highlight that there's some warranty work at the facility that's ongoing, so that's being taken care of by the contractors. Laboratory work goes on, as I mentioned, the land application. So there are minor expenditures really in the overall program, and the program, there are significant, the next significant expenditures in the future part of the budget relate to a new facility that will go in at South End. Once South End is complete and North End is up and running, there's a process. We're digesting all of our biosolids at one facility, so we'll be dewatering the biosolids that come out of South End, so we're only transporting dry tons and not water to be further treated at the North End and then reused. The subsequent events after this report has been reported in September, the Manitoba Sustainable Development approved all of our programs, and we continue to meet with them on a regular basis, and we'll be submitting finalized reports of our pilot program this year. The pilot program was to land apply up to 5,000 wet tons in contacts, about 10% of the total annual generation of biosolids with the City of Winnipeg. And we ended up with the program land applying about 3,000 wet tons, and the rest of the material was all used within the composting facility as well. So multiple streams of reuse for the biosolids coming out of North End. So that's the report at this time.
I would say this, Councillor Lukes, this is a happy report as well, because all of these biosolids are not being landfilled.
Which is
great.
I work with the RM of McDonald, and we've been discussing this project, so they're happy to receive it. So
good.
Yeah.
Yes, Councillor Mays?
Could you briefly clarify we didn't cut $200 million or $182 million out of this program in 16, we moved it over to the North End. We consolidated with the North End. Can you just clarify why that budgetary move was done? And that counts toward the $795 cost for North
End. The biosolids facility, like the major biosolids facility, will be located at the North End plant. And it was, it's the whole project, including the North End, including the biosolids facility that will be constructed. So it made more sense to put it there within the North End project.
Okay.
That's what we did.
Yeah, there were several risks identified with constructing them in separate fashions, and therefore it made sense to kind of bring it together. Yeah, we were funding them in separate programs, and then as we progressed with North End, it made sense. The number of critical tie-ins, the biosolids facility to the North End facility, it made sense to bring it together, and we put that forward as a report to council.
But we aren't building that yet. That's part of the whole.
That's part of the North End upgrade. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Other questions?
No.
Okay. Moved. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ms. Gear, Mr. Patton.
Ms. Close.
Thank you. Yes.
Can I just mention, Councillor Lukes asked this while I was looking at the balances there.
to provide a couple of policies. I know Ron and Valerie are here to speak on police next.
Sure. If you want to give those, we'll invite Mr. Smolik and Ms. Richard up, and while our CFO is providing those balances.
And Councilor, the balance for the Southwest Rapid Transit Corridor, the projected balance at the end of 2017.
Stage one or two?
That's stage one.
Stage one?
It doesn't say stage one. It was stage one, yeah. So it's $3.8 million, and the draw was 1.3 going towards the budget in 2018.
And that went to operating?
That's correct.
Okay.
So that will leave a balance of 2.5 in that reserve?
Sorry.
Yes, and there's some...
Sorry, Councilor.
Yeah, that's good.
And then the Southwest Rapid Transitway Stage 2 Pemmeda Highway Underpass Project. And the projected balance at the end of 2017 is $4.7 million. So those are two balances, and I owe you one other thing, and I'll circulate it to the rest.
Thank you.
Say that again for stage two.
$4.7 million at the end of 2000 projected at the end of 2017.
Surplus.
That's correct. Yeah, that's the balance in the reserve.
At the end of 2017.
Yes.
Got it. And then you were going to get me the breakdown of...
Yes. Yeah, I'm still out of that. I can't access it here.
Sure.
I'll get it
sure.
My desk.
Okay.
Okay. All right. Yes, we're on to the next item here. Winnipeg Police Service 2017 third quarter budget update. I want to welcome Mr. Smolik, controller for the Winnipeg Police Service, and Ms. Richard from the Winnipeg Police Board. So we will turn it over to you to present the highlights of the third quarter Winnipeg Police Service financial report.
Good morning, Mr. Chair. Police Service would like to present its third quarter 2017 results. I will highlight the salient items, the changes from the second quarter report. There aren't really a lot of changes from the second quarter. In photo enforcement, it's something that's very difficult to predict as to what the numbers are going to be. One of the impacts that we have during the summer is the construction ticketing that goes on. We did see some major increases in August and September in that quarter in construction ticketing, which helped to increase the number of revenue that we're expecting. However, with October and the earlier snowfall and the road conditions, we saw a dramatic decrease in the October numbers compared to last year. So we've had to revise the projection down a little bit when it comes to the code enforcement numbers for 2017. We're still projecting an overage compared to our budget, but we've had to decrease that quite a bit because of the reduction in the October numbers. The numbers that we saw in August, September for construction helped to increase the numbers, but again, that's very hard to predict how much that's going to be, depending on, even though there's a lot of construction activity going on, we may not be able to do the enforcement in those areas, depending on how the tower is set up.
Perhaps we'll ask questions as we go along, if that's
yes,
okay,
that's
on the talk. So I guess the one question, I mean, the report indicates on page 2, revenue projections are difficult to determine given outstanding court dispositions. And we talk often about the number of tickets that are, I'll use the word, challenged, for lack of a better word, in court. Do you have a breakdown or percentage of how many tickets are challenged in court? Is it 5%, 10%, 20%?
It would be significant. It would be more than 10 to 15%. We don't have the numbers, but again, the way the whole system is set up, everything goes to the province. They issue the tickets, so we know what we've issued for tickets.
Right.
But the actual oversight on that is all done by the province. So unless, and we don't have a system to track that, so I couldn't tell you if ticket A went into court, unless we did it manually, follow the whole trail of that, what's outstanding and what's still to come in. And that's why it's really difficult to pick up on the traditional enforcement. Code enforcement's a lot different, so I think we have a very good system on that, but on the traditional side, it's very hard to know what's actually outstanding at any point in time. The new act was proclaimed November 20th, so that will certainly help in about a year from now when we issue the tickets and they start going to court. It will certainly save us on the court overtime.
Can you just explain again? I know you've explained a couple times, just what is that new act and what will it do? Why will it save on court overtime? Just
what essentially happens is that the officers prepare a certificate of evidence at the time of the ticket that goes to the court system. So when it comes to someone actually contesting that ticket to the courts, the officer does not have to attend because that certificate of evidence will basically the plant that there was an offense that occurred at that time. So this way the officer does not have to attend to court, and we're hoping to save a couple hundred thousand dollars probably in 2019 once the tickets have to go to court, because then the officer won't be required to attend. But the actual collection on the revenue is, again, it goes to the court system. People present their case in front of the magistrate, the determination made at that time, and it's hard to predict or know on any particular ticket what that revenue is going to be.
Okay. Any further questions specific to that?
Okay. So, that's on the revenue side there. Our criminal record check revenues is kind of full. On expenses, again, the two significant events that happen on the salaries there and benefits is the savings on the collective agreement. That's going to save us $3.7 million this year. That's really no change from our second quarter forecast. Again, the good news for the service for 2017 is on the overtime numbers. A couple things happening on there. Probably the biggest change is the consolidation of the back offices from the General Patrol Division, consolidating all of that into the Major Crimes Division. So right now we're forecasting reduction of $500,000 to $600,000 on court savings, pardon me, on regular overtime savings from last year. So that's a significant savings in our regular overtime. Otherwise, the other services or other costs that we have within police service are basically on budget, and with the reduction in the provincial revenue of the $1.2 million and the savings of $3.7 million on the salaries, we're expecting to come in at $2 million better than our budget at the end of the year.
If I could just ask you then, if your savings according because of the new collective agreement is $3.7 million in 2017, how's that vary from your projected expenses? Like, what will the savings be in 2018?
Well, we've incorporated that into the 2018 budget submission, and as again we met the target for 2018 of the 1.2%, which was given to us, which would incorporate the increase in the 2.5% collective agreement increase for 2018, but also the savings that we incurred from 2017. I don't have an exact number for that, but again, if we saved $3.7 million in 2017, that would be offset by the 2.5% increase. That's actually a larger increase than the savings. Mm-hmm. So we're saving 2%.
Questions at all?
Sure. The only other, again, if you look at page 9, it shows the convert overtime hours, again, just showing you the significance of the drop in the overtime hours that we've had through the last couple of years. The service has always recognized that overtime has been a very high-profile number, so we've been really striving to work on those. And again, you know, the management practices that we've incorporated, system changes to again, increase that, the overtime coming in, we've got to monitor to make sure all the collective agreement. You can see that we've reduced overtime by, 24,000 hours in the last 2 years in the comparable quarters, which is a significant 10% drop. So that's, I think, a major accomplishment that the service has done for 2017. Otherwise, the only other big change is we had forecasted attrition of 43 for 2017. Looks like we'll be coming at a 51 officers retiring. Again, what's also having an impact on our financial numbers a bit is that our staff retirements has also increased quite a bit. Many of us getting to that baby boomer age where we're looking at retirement, so we expect to see an increase in attrition in that area in the next couple of years as well.
Okay.
With that, those would be the selling changes in our budget for in our forecast for 2017.
Thank you. I've got a question regarding, I guess, their hard costs. On page 10, it indicates that 2017 salary costs are 84.3% of your total costs of the services expenditures. But then there's also, if I can find it here, page 2 talks about debt and finance charges and facility costs. Facility costs are 11.35% higher due to the new headquarters costs being charged for the full year. So I guess the salary costs are hard costs. Like those are fixed. Those don't vary except over time up and down. Debt, finance charges, and facility costs are hard costs as well. What if salary costs are 84%, what percent of the budget is debt, finance, facility costs?
It is a significant part. I know we've done some analysis for the police force showing that the portion of our overall budget on debt and financing has increased from 20% of the non-salary to 40% of the non-salary. But if we're looking at, again, if we're looking at debt and financing and about $18 million out of our budget, so $18 million out of the $288, you're looking at, you know, 8 to 9% approximately to the quick number of what portion that is of our whole budget. So you've got 84% on the 85 for salaries, almost 9 or 10 facilities. So we have 25% of your budget. The other 5% would be all your services and other equipment that we need.
This is, and going back a couple of years, you know, when I had the privilege of serving as chair of the board, this is one thing that just became very apparent pretty quick, is that the hard costs, the hardwire costs, are over 90%. Perhaps even you said upwards of 95% of the costs. They're not movable. They can't be adjusted because they're locked and loaded costs in the budget. So. You know, I said it before, and last week when I was asked about it, I'll say it again. I know there's a lot of scrutiny of the police service, as there should be, but I commend the police service for the 2017, what they were able to accomplish in managing the budget when you've got, you know, upwards of 95%, maybe 92 to 93% of the costs in the budget that are hard-coded, and then get... news like the, you know, that was the news that the province gave in regards to freezing funding to 2015 levels, not 16. You know, the service was able to make some adjustments, and granted, as you said too, the collective agreement results really assisted this year in a big way as well. But just wanted to point that out, that I do appreciate, you know, that over 90% of the budgeted costs are fixed costs. Yes, Councillor Lard.
I did have a question. In terms of the forecast, the appendix says in the non-salary area, costs are expected to increase $250,000 related to photo radar expenses in conjunction with an increase in the volume of photo enforcement tickets being issued. Do you know why there's an expectation that there might be more tickets issued?
We had the construction ticketing that occurred in August, September, so there's some extra tickets as well. But really, the fee that we pay, the per ticket cost for every reservation, so the volume increases, we pay more money. Again, at the same time, revenue increases. We've got a 3-to-1 relationship between the revenue and expenses. So if we see our revenue going up $100,000, we'd expect the cost to go with that go up by $33,000.
Okay.
So it really depends on volume. So the two things that we're seeing in the photo enforcement is the weather and road conditions will affect memberships being issued, especially when we're getting to the winter season. And also, we expect over time that people will slow down. So all other things being equal, the number of tickets that we're issuing, we should see less tickets. Just overall, because people should be learning to slow down. We have a lot of other programs, you know, when it comes to our Just Slow Down program, telling people to slow down. So ideally, our goal is to have zero tickets issued.
Right.
But I don't think we'll ever see that, but that's what our hope is.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions regarding this third quarter financial report? Councilor Macy.
Is there an average retirement age that we usually use?
It's between 20 and 29 years for officers.
Okay, service.
Yes, service.
Yeah. Not age.
Oh, yeah, yeah,
not
yeah,
age of the officer.
Explain our question. So roughly early 50s then, or is that?
I think the average age is about 53, 54.
Okay.
Any further questions?
I'll move it.
Okay. Moved. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Carried. Thank you. Moving to item number 7, Winnipeg Police Board 2017 quarterly budget update. Ms. Richard.
Thank you. So you've got the numbers before you. The Winnipeg Police Board reviewed and received this as information on December 1st. You'll see that, as in previous years, the board is on track to operate within its budget for 2017. Given that this is significantly less money than what we were speaking about with the service, I'm not sure if you'd like a lot of detail for the board budget, but I'm happy to take any questions.
Any questions at all? I'll just say yes. It's, you know, it's scalable. It's not, you know, the size of really any other department's budget. However, it's the principle of, you know, working within the means that are given, and so that's I know that's appreciated and acknowledged as well. So maybe I'll take this opportunity. I believe he's not here today, but the executive director Don Norquay has announced his retirement. And so maybe we'll take this opportunity, in case we don't get the chance, just to put on the record, express our appreciation to Mr. Norquay for his years of service. He was really here at the outset, the establishment of the board, which predates three of us on this committee. You know, Councillor Mays was around on City Council when the Winnipeg Police Board was established, Mr. Norquay was the first executive director and really did yeoman's work in really establishing the board. And I know our clerk, Mr. Armbruster, was there in many of the, you know, all the meetings as well. So we do want to express our appreciation to Mr. Norquay and wish him all the best as he's retiring early in 2018. So it's come to my attention that is this your last meeting?
Your last meeting as well? Oh, it is, yes. I'm transferring to another department in January.
Oh, okay. Well, there we go. Well, then I'll express my appreciation to you, because I had the privilege of working with you for 2 years, Mallory, and very, very excellent work that you always did, and very conscientious and a lot of hard effort to all the tasks that were assigned to you. So thank you to you and your work for the police board, and we wish you all the best in your transfer and your new role.
Thank you so much.
Okay, good. Okay, so that is our report, number 7. I'll entertain a motion then to receive the report. Okay, Councillor Allard, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay, motion to consent agenda adjournment. Okay, thank you very much. All in favor?
Aye.
Carry. Thank you.
Everybody at some point.
Yeah.